Thank you all for coming, and thanks to this great panel for taking some time out to discuss a really important topic, the future of leadership for the mountain travel industry or family of industries. I wanted to just sort of set a little bit of a context for this conversation and sort of put the wheels in motion to explain a little bit about why this is important to you as current and future leaders of the industry. So with that, so let me just talk about it. So my company is called Great Place to Work, and you might know Great Place to Work from the Fortune magazine 100 Best Companies to Work For list, which was released 2 weeks ago. And that work is the result of tons of research that we do from the 40 million employees that are assessed and through our survey tool, and we come up with an amazing criteria for determining who the best companies are, not just in the United States, but in lists all over the world. But more important to you and to this conversation is that we have other best workplaces lists that we pull together. For instance, the best workplace for women, best workplaces for millennials, best workplaces for diversity, and industry-specific lists such as, you know, financial services, consulting, banking, and so on and so forth. So, why that's relevant here is because there is an opportunity in this industry to really change the nature of the direction of leadership. I think there's some, the panel's gonna share some really interesting statistics with you and some of their experiences and stories about why this topic is particularly important and relevant to you all. And we'll go ahead and jump right in. But I wanted to share a couple of quick statistics about why almost everything that Kelly was talking about is related to leadership in so many ways. So did you know that organizations that are considered great workplaces and great workplaces for everybody, not just the people making a lot of money. Here we go. Fantastic. Thank you. That'll be up in 2 seconds. There we go. This is the one I want to talk about. So certified great workplaces, and these are organizations that are certified by us as great workplaces, outperform all other organizations in terms of their business growth. And when you compare them to the S&P 400, for instance, even medium and large companies alike outperform by a lot, 3 times those other organizations. So there's a business need to really focus on creating and understanding how to make leadership accessible to all. Another quick point I wanted to make was, we can go on to the next one, perfect. Is that no matter what the industry, we have there's something we all probably work with, which is voluntary turnover, and that's when people quit their jobs because they don't like it. And we all know that most people quit their jobs because they don't like their boss. So no matter what industry, if you have a great workplace, people tend to not want to leave those organizations. Similarly, with generations, millennials, Gen Xers, and baby boomers want to work at their organizations for a long time when they feel like it's a great place to work. So if you are, no matter what your generation is or the composition of your organizations, know that people really value a very positive workplace experience. And then finally, when it comes to women in particular, these are results of just women survey takers. And the two big themes that separate great workplaces from just okay workplaces are things like having a voice and fairness. And if you can see them on the bottom of the screen, these are survey questions that we have in our survey. So you can dive into the detail all you want, but I wanted to talk to our panel about this and really focus on this question of leadership. So I'll throw it out to all of you, and this is gonna be a round robin. I'll let you all decide who's gonna talk first. So to mix it up a little bit, okay? So why is this topic of refining and reshaping what leadership looks like in the industry important? Why are we talking about this today, in your opinion?
I'll start.
All right, go ahead.
I think it has everything to do with change. And, you know, at the resort, we've seen enormous change in the last 10 years of our physical plan, which has led to change in who our customers are. And probably more importantly, it's how we are communicating in 2017. When I was growing up, I hate to tell a hardship story here, but I literally had to walk 10 feet through shag carpet to change the channel of the TV.
Poor thing.
Now I can talk to Alexa and change
that kind
happens.
That kind of experience hardens a person, right? I mean, that makes you tough. It's character.
It does. That's how I got in shape. But seriously, the you know, leadership through change, and especially through communication, because people are getting information from places that they've just never gotten the information before. You know, you just look at the way the government's running by 140 characters. I know bosses that are just have the Heisman out there for change, and I kind of feel sorry for them a little bit, as opposed to embracing change. And I think future leadership, if you're on the side of the road on change, and especially in communication, you're going to stay there.
Yeah. Well, we know the world is changing, and we all have to change along with it. So other Olivia.
Well, I work with Mike on the resort side, and we have a very urgent need for a transition in leadership and a focus on who those next leaders are going to be. Something that our current NSCA, National Ski Areas Association director, has been saying in the past few months, and by the way, he just announced he's retiring, is that 37% of the GMs on the resort management side are right now 60 plus, and 58% of them have been at their jobs for 30 plus years, so we have not had a change in quite some time. And then in the next 5 years, half of that group are going to be retiring. So with them leaves all of this skills and experience, but it opens up a huge opportunity for a new leadership, a diverse leadership. I think it's no secret that on the resort side, it's a aging white male population, and I think there's a great opportunity when you hear those stats to bring about change through new leadership. So that's exciting and a little daunting, those stats.
Yeah. Yeah.
I'll jump in real quick. And then I think to situate that in an even larger framework, there's a statistic right now that if we continue to hire, retain, advance, as we've done, so maintain the status quo, there'll be a 40 million worker shortage by 2020. And just for a frame up, the status quo right now from a recent Lean-In survey was that for every 100 women who get promoted out of manager, 130 men get promoted out of manager. So I think we need to start looking at, and to your point around great places to work, it's that I think that the opportunity for companies to really understand not only do they need to be the brand of choice for consumers, but given the shortage of skilled workers, as representatives of our companies, we're gonna have to start thinking about how do we become the employer of choice? How does our brand become an employer of choice? And almost put as much time and energy and attention into really cultivating that as we are consumers and driving people to our resorts and to our companies.
That's great, thanks.
Yeah, I have no statistics like that, except I've been in media all my career, and I when I was at a company where there was gender diversity at the leadership level, it was a better place to work, and it was more profitable, and there was less turnover. And I don't know how much turnover costs, 30% of the person's salary, but there was no turnover or there was little turnover when there was gender diversity at the places I've been. And the first and foremost place was Rodale, which is a publishing company and media company. And it was, when I was there, it was run by Ardith Rodale, and she was phenomenal. And we all wanted to work hard for her. And that feeling was throughout the entire company. It was a great place to work, and it was very profitable.
That's great.
So capitalist at heart.
Yeah, yeah. When you think about sort of other things that are changing in the industry, we talk about certainly the aging out of senior executives, for instance, is one thing that's happening. What else is happening that's keeping this thriving, or that's threatening the thriving of the industry at the moment, like external forces, internal forces?
Well, for sure, the aging boomer population, they're participating less in our sport, and we've kind of been sustained by their population. They're aging out, and they represented 10 participation skier days. The millennial generation, which is kind of our next group to sustain us, right now only make up 5 participation days per season. So there's a big question is how are we going to sustain the industry with with growth when we have to figure out how to attract new skiers and find ways to connect and engage with the millennials.
Yeah, excellent. Melissa, I want to ask you a question about sort of the choices that consumers make and who are the consumers that tend to make these choices around travel. I think that's kind of a softball for you, but just sort of there's a way to kind of unpack it in the context of how that drives your internal decision-making at Expedia.
Sure. We have a stat that we refer to quite a bit that 85% of all the purchases are influenced or done by a woman. So we've looked at that from a, you know, who is our customer standpoint, and we've actually focused on diversity quite a bit at Expedia. And, you know, there's tons of studies that diverse teams produce more, and we've said we really want to focus on women as far as which segment. We want to focus on them all, but women is really where we look at. And what we've seen is women drop off. As you go up the level, women drop off at the director level within our company, and then the vice president level really drop off. So we're looking at, you know, we want to make sure that we have women leaders to connect with our consumers, of course, but also just have a better workplace. So we've got a lot of interesting programs that we're putting into place that are for women, but also for young leaders to try to keep them in the organization to attract and promote young leaders and young women leaders in particular.
Okay, so let me see if I can just sort of summarize the context for everyone, and you can sort of check me to see if there's any additional, anything you want to add to this. But basically what we have is a situation where we have a lot of older white gentlemen running an industry or set of industries that is driven primarily by the decision-making and purchasing power of women, and there aren't a lot of sort of mid-level managers necessarily to take those who are women to take up the kinds of leadership roles that might enhance that kind of perspective. We also know from data that, you know, more diverse workplaces are much more profitable, much more sustainable, and do well. How dire is it? Is the question. Like, what? How big is the problem that we're dealing with today?
I guess it's as big as you want to make it, because, you know, I believe in titles and I believe in position. But a coworker of mine came to this event last year and spoke at Ignite, and I'll give her a plug, Lauren Simmers, and she had in 5 minutes four ways that resorts can be more user-friendly to young families and moms. And I watched it because it's still out there on YouTube, and I thought, wow, we're not doing any of those four. And it made a huge impact on me, because while she handles a certain segment of our business, when she came home, I said, you know, you can do this. And in fact, she did do this. And now I'm pleased to say two of the four things we're presently doing, and it's made us a better resort. Actually, there's a product called Mamaval. We're the first ski resort, I believe, in North America, maybe the world, to have one of those. Look it up if you don't know what it is.
Say it again.
Mamaval. It's a Vermont-based company, but they're everywhere. I'm seeing them at airports.
And it's a nursing pod, right?
It is.
Yeah.
But the point is, you know, we have this in a primary or in a focal point at the resort, and A, people are using it. People are going by saying, wow, they're really embracing that. But from a leadership perspective, you know, she grabbed those initiatives, and we have a tough IT group. She got a ticket product through that we offered this season. And so, you know, I look at, and I work with a whole room full of people that I consider leaders, doing things in their own areas that are challenging the resort, challenging the business, because, you know, they say the business is stagnant, and visits might show that. But, you know, we've done a couple things for young adults and millennials that have grown our business by $1 million this season. And it all comes from, you know, people with drive, people with ideas. And I can tell you, it's not me. And it's all the people, all the leaders that I work with.
Yeah. So on that note, so I'd love to hear a little bit. So now that we have the context set, understanding a little bit more about what you've seen work in some organizations that you currently work in or had contact with, and particularly paying attention to the effect it has on the organization itself and the employees, right? So I could imagine that implementing Mamaval not only is something that makes your resort more accessible and attractive to women buyers, but it must have had some impact on the individuals who got it up and running, got it, got the buy-in required, and actually implemented it successfully too, right?
Just, you know, it was in our capital project plan for last year, which was based on the year before, historically the worst winter that we've ever had. And she went out and got the $17,000 in funds to get this done. I didn't do that. She did that. And so, again, from a leader perspective, the resort grew enormously by the leadership skills of this individual. And I think she's the future. I think people that take those ideas are the future.
Awesome. That's great. What else have you seen work?
One of the things that we've done is educate our managers literally around the world on why we have biases and why, you know, why diversity matters. And we used to have a women's leadership group at Expedia, and 2 years ago we invited men into the women's leadership. And at first I thought, this is kind of strange, but it was really interesting to see the reaction that the men had and change their perception. And shortly after that, we put in an initiative where in every interview loop on the tech side, because our tech teams are very, very male-dominated, we had put a woman through every single interview loop and then had a woman interview as well. So it took us a little bit longer to make sure that we had those candidates, but it really made it, you know, made a difference, and we're seeing results out of that.
So why? What was the business need to do that from your company's point of view?
Again, it goes back to our consumer and who's making the buying decisions, and then the key point that diverse teams matter. So we thought if we could put a couple of those things into initiatives that we can see the results of, it would be beneficial. Another thing that we're doing is we're testing, so I don't have results yet, but we're removing names from resumes so that there's not that bias of looking at a resume and thinking someone is a certain gender or a certain race, et cetera. And so we've just rolled that out, and that'll be interesting to see the results. But again, trying to make sure that the biases are thrown away.
That's phenomenal.
And I think when you look at the population we want to reach, and it just makes sense to have the leadership represent that population. If you know the women are making the decisions for travel, you know, it just makes sense. And I think that's, you know, getting, I like that you have the men seeing what they might not see if they're in charge, which is, you know, it's not a cause, it's not a checkbox, it's not a charity, it's not I need to do this because it's the right thing to do. It's because it's good business sense,
right?
And that's what it should just come down to. It's just good business sense. If you want to reach the Latino market, get some Latino representation in your leadership. If you want to reach the females, get them on your leadership team. I think that's what I think it should come down to. It's business.
And I think that the people in the room, probably the biggest opportunity that you have is that you're hiring the next generation of leaders. And irrespective of where you are in your job at this time, one of the leadership skills that we all need to continue to cultivate is that of learning to incorporate diverse experiences, perspectives that maybe aren't our own, and start hiring people that challenge us and challenge the way we're thinking. And I could talk stats until I'm blue in the face, so I won't. But there was a recent study. It was JCPenney's, but they looked at hiring to represent their community. And when they did that, they had a significant increase in 1 year of their revenue. And a couple of reasons why. One really surprised me was, they actually just sent a message to the consumers and potential consumers that they weren't discriminating. So I think if we think about the resorts and who's the face of the industry, is often those people who were hiring at the entry level. And so just being really thoughtful about how we're hiring and who we're bringing in so that it represents those consumers that we already have, but also those that we're trying to attract. And another reason that this is so critical to every person in this room is we've seen in the industries, I work in outdoor bike, run, snow, we see that the track to leadership is fairly organic. And so what happens is someone comes into the industry at, you know, what appears to be an entry level, it could be retail, it could be the resort, and that's really their opportunity and their entree into the industry. And so making sure that As you're hiring and you're looking at building your teams, whether they're consumer facing or whether they're behind the scenes, really making a concerted effort that the candidate pool at least reflects your consumer base. I think Kent can talk a little bit about how he, some work that he did at his last job around kind of the Rooney Rule, but it's not a quota system. It's not saying you have to hire X number of women or X number of racial and ethnic people, but it's really saying, are we advertising, are we communicating in a way that we're getting the diverse and best talent into the candidate pool so then we can make the choice of hiring the best person for the job to move the company forward?
Yeah, I think there's two parts to that. I don't know if you're familiar with the Rooney Rule. It was Art Rooney at the NFL, I don't know how many years ago. Every new head coach position that was available, there had to be two African-American candidates, qualified candidates that they interviewed. So I think part of this is what Kelly talked about, which is culture. And I was in a position at Active Interest Media, and for most of you, that would be Ski Skiing, Warren Miller, where I was running those groups. And it was a cultural issue that needed to be changed. It was very difficult because there was somewhat of a yo bro culture that was really hard to dig into and to change. And so you asked, what was one of the most important things we did? We got involved with Camber. I was not on the board. We got involved with Camber through the CEO pledge. And that just unleashed a wave of people in the company to say, hey, this matters. And that's when I became more involved in the Rooney Rule. I had 10 people reporting to me, and they were all men. And that was a cultural problem. And when I left, there were it was 40% women. But I think that's only half of it. I think that was the easy part. Hiring qualified, making sure that we interviewed qualified women was the easy part. I think the hard part is making sure that they're paid at the same level and pace as men. And that's the difficult part. It's super challenging, the pushback to, hey, we can save some money here.
Yeah. So I want to sort of put the audience back on my favorite slide from Kelly, actually, which is the fire, fear thing, right? So this is, you know, anytime we talk about something being different tomorrow than it is today, that's change, right? So, and we all know that change is very hard for people, and one of the responses to change is resistance, pushing back, finding all kinds of rationale for why not to do something differently. So I'd love to maybe hear some experiences that you all have had around resistance. Like what have you seen and heard? What have you felt coming back your way as you've advanced some of these controversial concepts, like putting, you know, qualified women in leadership roles? So what have some of those stories been like for you? Or share some of those stories.
I sit on a board of an organization that's maybe 30 or 40 years old. It's a communications board of what they do, because I'm on a couple boards. And the company that we manage is stagnant. The product is stagnant, the product hasn't changed. And I looked around the table, and it's an old boys board. And they've offered me membership, a junior membership, but I've turned it down. I sat at a board meeting less than a half a year ago, and I said, we need to get somebody about 20 years younger. And it could be a male, it could be a female. We need change in this organization. And what I got back was, no, we only want people on this board who can make decisions for resorts. And I thought, boy, that's not going to be how you're going to win that game. And that's very, very frustrating. Mm-hmm. I actually haven't been to the two last meetings because of that, because nothing's going to change if people don't embrace reality, the reality of 2017.
Yep.
Mike, is that the NSCA board?
No. We're naming names, folks.
Were you referring to the NSCA board?
No.
Okay.
Absolutely not. I'm not on the board of NSAA.
I thought you were, okay. Nope. That would be my thing, is that I just received the notice of the board and the nominations for the new board members, and it is sadly the same old boys club, and I thought you were describing the NSAA board, to be honest.
That's it's
resort related, but yeah. it's not, and it's doomed in my opinion.
Yeah, and I would say on a personal story, and maybe it's extreme, and it was a number of years ago, and things have changed a little, but you know, I remember being out, and it was earlier in my career when I'd just taken over the magazine, and my father had started the magazine, you know, in 1962. So, you know, we took it over, and we were at a dinner with a lot of the head, you know, big resort owners, like the main guys, and we were invited, and I remember sitting there, and we were told, we as my sister and I, so you're not gonna think that you can, you know, run this magazine and keep it going, you know, is what is your brother doing? Is your brother gonna get involved? And this is exact quotes from them that, you know, you're gonna have a hard time as a female doing what your father did in this industry, and it wasn't even a question of could we, it was just put on the table that, you know, you it's not gonna be possible for you. So that was a good message for me to get early in my career, and it only fueled the fire to prove them wrong, but I think that also informed how it was gonna be for the next, you know, 15 years, and that's what I hope this next generation won't have going forward, is when they come in, that we'll have more of an understanding that there's a need for.
Well, I think as a testament to what you've done, you know, when I get that email every day, I hope they spell my name right and it's positive. So I think everybody's, you're well respected.
Thank you. Can I give a quick little plug? So one of the things that we did, I forgot to mention this, is there's cards on everyone's chairs. And one of the things that we found really effective is as you're listening to this talk or even throughout the day, if there are things that you want to remember, just jot them down. We have envelopes up here, and at some point, come find either Kent or myself. We address the envelope to you, and then once you're done and you're back and you're skiing and you forget all about this, we send you your postcard or your note card, and it just refreshes your memory about the things that you're learning or the key takeaways that you want to make sure that you retain while you're here. But when I started my job about 5 years ago, there were two women who were very respected and prominent in the industry. They called them the Sallys. It was Sally Jewell, who was running REI, and Sally McCoy, who was running Camelback. And the first thing I did when I got hired, of course, was I called them and said, I took over this organization, and I just want to have a conversation with you. Sally Jewell called me back and said, if you're asking me to speak, I've already said no, don't ask me again. She was very efficient, but she also offered to open the door for a conversation. Sally McCoy took time out and met with me again and again and again. But the first piece of advice that both of them gave me was to read a book called Switch, How to Change When Change is Hard. And if you have read that or if you haven't read that, I highly recommend it because it also looks at bright spots. And so that's one thing that we try to do as an organization is we try to focus on those things that have worked and emulate them and provide those as examples moving forward. Because I think a lot of times it's easy to remember what's not working or what's hard or something that is not, you know, it's just not working. And to me, that's not good information to move forward with. And so if you do read it or you have read it, there's a pledge in there. And it's not surprising that we launched the CEO pledge. I literally read the chapter and go, oh, maybe we should do this for our industry. So I do think that there are ways to help usher in change that aren't painful, that are actually very inclusive and welcoming of everyone and everyone's opinion.
That's great. So write CEO pledge on that card and then bring it up and we'll get you information about the CEO pledge because it makes a difference. It really.
That's right. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, I think having a conversation is one thing. Making a commitment is definitely taking it to the next level. And I think there's lots of leaders in this room who not only have formal authority through their roles, but also informal authority to influence their organization. So it'd be great to have folks remind, you know, even if 10 from one organization get the same postcard back and say, remember, isn't that weird that we all just said this? And let's do it, yeah.
Well, I actually had, so when we launched it, one of my board, he's now a board member, he goes, yeah, I was at work, it was literally after this was announced, and four of my best employees came to me and said, why haven't you signed this yet? And he goes, I signed it. So there's also, you know, irrespective of where you are in your organization, You bring power and influence to those who are the decision makers by telling them that this is important to you and by making it a priority internally.
Melissa, did you want to
agree? Well, just to tag on to that, you know, what I would encourage the audience to do is, you know, make those changes. They can be small changes. We were having drinks last night with some of my team, and one of our leaders is having triplets. And I said, you know, are you going to go out on paternity leave, which we fully endorse at Expedia? We don't have as many people take advantage of it, unfortunately. But within the group, they're doing something unique to make sure that he doesn't have to travel as much, the rest of the team can support him, the business still runs. And that was just something really small that they did. And we, you know, we're doing some things in my team where we're doing a test right now. I have two of our strategic leaders within my team who are women who are, we're testing part-time. And so it was something that we just said, okay, let's do. We don't have to have a formal policy at Expedia around this, but let's test it. So we're looking at some of those, you know, small wins or small tests that we can figure out, does this work? Is it right for the employee? Can the business still run efficiently? And then we can roll them out further. So I'd say just go do it.
Cool. Okay, so I'm a boy, as you can see. And I'm a white boy, and I wanted to, there may be others out there.
So I want to
talk about me, how I should be receiving this conversation, really. Because I think, you know, one way to kind of take all this information in is to kind of say, yeah, that's great, I'm on board, I see the business benefit, makes a lot of sense. Behind all of that, though, could be some fear around, like, am I kind of putting myself in a position to replace myself or something? So help me and them understand how men should be taking this conversation in.
You should quit your job and let a woman replace you.
Excellent. See, well, there you have it.
I hear that all the time.
Besides that, let's assume there's enough seats at the table. I think it's important, right? So what do you think? What do you suggest?
Yeah, I think it's a great question, and all of my vice presidents are men, and they've all asked that question. Because as we're bringing transparency to the topic, there is that concern out there. One of the things that is a core principle with us is diverse teams work better, but ultimately the best person for the job, regardless of anything, is going to get the position or stay in the position. So we reinforce that. For men on my team, it is, you know, how do you support this initiative? How do you, you know, help educate this initiative and really talk about it? You know, we don't want to replace the men, but we want to get them involved in the conversation. And again, it goes back to why are we doing it? You know, a lot of my men leaders are negotiators. It's a lot of studies that women negotiate differently than men and a little bit softer. So those are the types of examples that we talk about. But again, just making sure that the men know they're not going to be eliminated, and they're obviously still an extremely important part of the workplace.
Fantastic.
So still quit.
Well, I think they could be invited in to, you know, to be a mentor, which is an empowering thing. So maybe it's if you want to eventually get their job, you know, you ask to, in an informal way, to for them to mentor you and take an interest in learning their skills, and that may be a smoother transition where it doesn't feel like for that male that he's being made redundant. And you know, and if he's the boss and he's got a smart team coming up that he can mentor, that's a good thing. He should be stepping aside and letting them, you know, make, you know, and impact and changes and ideas and bring that all. I mean, that's a good position to be in as a boss, is that you are made redundant, because it means you've taught your team well. So maybe that's a way for a male to invite that next generation in.
Here's my litmus test, and this is an actual conversation I had. I'm not going to name names. And so if you think, when I tell you what this conversation is, if you think it's okay, then you are a relic and your business is going to be impacted by that. But if you think there's something wrong, then make change, okay? So here's the conversation. It's my business manager, who happens to be a woman. It's a senior vice president, who happens to be a man, who works for me. We're discussing another employee in the company, and he says, Well, she can't really do the job because she has two kids, and I know what that does to her hormones, and I know how that will affect. Okay, so if you think that's okay, I think that's going to affect the way your company grows in the future. And that's the litmus test that I would have. If you don't think it's okay, then make a change. Do something about it. You can. Everybody here has a choice. Quit your job if you can't change that. But if you can make a change, fight hard to make that change.
If you think that's okay, don't take a postcard.
Yeah, don't take a postcard. The best part about that conversation was the business manager, who was the best business manager I ever had, feisty, and she, I didn't have to do anything. There was no sort of, I gotta record this for HR because this is a problem. She lit into him to the degree that we fixed the problem. So it's self-selected result.
It's, I mean, there's something about immediate feedback that really helps in those cases, right?
You don't have to pull her off.
Yeah.
So do you feel threatened by this conversation?
Me personally?
Yeah, or anyone?
Well, I from the mindset of a male, I think, you know, I go to the place of, you know, of holding two different pieces of the puzzle. So I don't feel threatened by the conversation, but I also wonder what I can do specifically. So, like, you know, minding my attitude and my bias, like recognizing the fact that I, like everybody, has biases as well, and they can pop up from time to time. Being open to feedback when people say, "Hey, do you realize what you just said? What you just did? You know, do you know how that landed with others, and you know how that might have been perceived?" And just being willing to hear it back. And then third thing is really just to take, you know. Not boil the ocean in a day. We'll be willing to take a couple of steps forward and maybe one step back, but you know, keep working at it and recognizing that at the end of the day, you know, working on your values is ultimately going to be better than sort of staying entrenched in your own perspective. You know, so not threatened, but I also realize that it's work. It's work.
I listen to podcasts, and sometimes I force my staff to listen to them, and there's this really interesting one by a woman. Her name is Eula Biss. It's E-U-L-A-B-I-S-S, and she wrote a piece in the New York Times, and I think she also wrote an article, a book, but it was more on white and white privilege, and the podcast I listened to is On Being by Krista Tippett, and in the middle of it, she talked about opportunity hoarding. And as white women, my staff and I, we really tried to have a dialogue and understand when we were taking advantage of opportunities, and that by us taking advantage of them, someone else wouldn't be able to take advantage of it. And so I think for me that, and for us, that was a big awakening on, you know, how we personally can start to share the pie. And I think at the end of the day, the BHAG or the big vision is that our pie gets bigger. So it's not about replacing, it's about adding. And by adding, we're, as an industry, we're attracting the talent that we're pulling it, we're able to pull it from other industries, and we're able to grow our industry in a way that we wouldn't be able to if we weren't attracting the diverse talent.
Yeah. So my line of work, which is like organizational change, there's a phrase from a researcher from a long time ago, and the phrase is, your organization is perfectly designed to get the results you're getting right now. Mm. So maybe you're satisfied with the results, and maybe many organizations represented in this room are quite profitable, but the point of that statement is, imagine what would happen. Imagine to the results or whatever you're striving for if you were to just change a little bit, you know, change your attitude. So I think if you go back to that, you know, the slide about, you know, organizations that are certified as great places to work, organizations that people want to come to every day, they outperform organizations that are just simply getting it done, with the kinds of conversations that you were talking about, Ken. So I think it's like reframing what success looks like for all of us, and for the industry and the organizations that represent it, so that we're not sort of defining what we can do by what we are currently achieving. You know, so I think so thinking about how you're currently designed and recognizing that it's all on purpose, right? So how you're designed is really sort of a precursor to the results you're getting right now. So if that's not a motivation to change. I'm not quite sure what is, but.
Can I ask a quick question?
Yeah.
So, sorry, am I moderating? I'm
kind of taking over. Actually, you can take
okay.
It doesn't even,
So with the woman who presented last year, did she receive a promotion or the, Mike?
Yeah, Mike.
Yeah, Mike, when you had talked about the woman who had presented last year and she came away with four great ideas, and you've implemented them, as an organization, you know, have you been able to acknowledge that and recognize her and her contribution? Sorry to put you on the spot,
no, but
I feel like these are the really important conversations that when someone shows that they want the initiative for a woman to really recognize that and feed it and also acknowledge it for her is really important.
I used that example earlier because it's why I'm sitting here today.
Okay.
You know, but that is just a snapshot of other things that she has brought to the resort. And I don't mean to be picking on her because I'll pick on a couple more of my staff in a minute. But the, everybody's got their jobs. And she said in the summertime, listen, why do we have this certain piece of collateral come out, you know, on November 1st when I could use it on October 1st to do my job better? And we all looked around saying, okay, if you want to take that project, a marketing project, and she did, it delivered on time. And that's one of 100 things that this one individual does. We have another woman in our group who has a vision. She runs all of our special events. She has a staff of one, but yet she has the race department, she has mountain ops, she has the facilities team, and she puts on events every single weekend and like as the orchestrates all of these different groups, none of whom report to her. And in fact, on the planning meeting on Wednesday, I don't even go to it because she's just good at what she does. And I know these are two women that I've talked about, but there's another person who I work with who came to me 2 or 3 years ago and said, there is a national event that I want to bring to the East for the first time. He had a vision. And it's happening next weekend, the Hall of Fame event up at the resort, first time in the East. And it's going to be 500 or 600 people, and that's not his job. But he had a vision, and he had the organization, he had he knew the people in the industry, and he got it done. And so these are all what I consider young people that are not looking at their job titles, they're not looking at their what they should be doing. They're not clocking in from 9 to 5. They're growing our resort. And so, you know, if I were to not come home tomorrow, we'd be just as good as we are today. I do have some ideas, but.
I'm sure you do.
And so, I do think it's important to, as you had said, to recognize and point out, you know, we do something at our magazine called the 10 Under 30, the annual 10 Under 30, and it's a great way to capture, you know, those diamonds in the rough and put them out there. And the nicest thing that we can see, you know, A, is, you know, you can follow, like, I'm sure some of you know Hallie O'Brien. She does the snow report for Ski Magazine. She's everywhere. She's the video queen for the industry. And she was a 10 under 30. She was on our cover of the magazine back in 2011, and she was sort of the PR gal at Mountain Creek. You know, very, you know, mid, lower level job, entry level at that point. And last year, in 2016, she won our SAMI Leadership Award. And it's neat to watch. And she said, if you talked to her about it, she said, you know, it was a boost I needed at a time in my career that just made me feel like I could do anything when she got that cover in the 10 under 30. And she said it got me instant recognition with the crowd that didn't know I existed, and it just provided opportunity. And then the SAMI thing last year just was an evolution of her career to then get the next level of an award. And you know, I have no doubt we're going to be seeing her on all the Good Morning America shows, you know, selling our industry. And that's and she stayed with our industry. And I think the problem we have is a lot of this talent get frustrated because they just remain in that din of, you know, non-acknowledgement. And, you know, when we award the lifetime achievements and the folks on their way out, you know, we've made it a focus of the magazine to really capture the next generation and make sure it's diverse always.
That's awesome.
I think that's an important part of keeping people in the industry.
For sure. Mm-hmm. Yep, absolutely. So two calls to action for the group here today. One is obviously complete write your takeaways and maybe even your commitments on this card and hand it back to Deanne whenever you see her. She'll be up here after this or over there after this. And secondly, take a look at the Great Place to Work card, where there's an opportunity to learn a little bit more about qualifying your organization to be on our best workplaces list. And you get really great data to get a sense of where you are right now with some of those questions that that we showed you a little bit earlier. So if you want to put yourself on a path to be the kind of organization that we've been talking about, check that out as well. So I want to thank the panel very much for a great conversation. We're going to continue the conversation at 2:15. We've got a breakout session where you get a chance to talk and interact and ask questions back to the panelists. And we're going to gather up all that information and share it back with the whole industry after the conference. But please join us at 2:15 for some more lively dialogue with our panelists. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. Thanks, everybody.